الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين. اللهم لك الحمد كله ولك الشكر كله وإليك يرجع الأمر كله علانيته وسره إنك على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وحبيبه، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في الله حق الجهاد حتى أتاه اليقين. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارك على الحبيب المصطفى محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهديه وعمل بسنته إلى يوم الدين، وارض عنا معهم بفضلك وكرمك أرحم الراحمين. اللهم آمين. I praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of heavens and earth, the provider, the giver, the cherisher, the sustainer. I thank Allah for His blessings upon each and every one of us, and I express my gratitude with words and action. I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. And I bear witness that Muhammad is Allah's final prophet and messenger, and the bearer of glad tidings, and the role model to be followed, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May the peace and the blessings of Allah be upon him and his family, his companions, his followers and students, and every man or woman that is inspired by the teachings of Muhammad until the Day of Judgment. And I ask Allah to make each and every one of us among them. Allahumma ameen. Brothers and sisters, growing up, we are always told about that little story in the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which he was still in the custody of Halima al-Sa'diyya, who nursed him and took care of him when he was a child. And then one of those days, you remember the story, when Halima's son, Halima's actual son, and Muhammad, they were with each other and they were playing. And then they were visited by an angel, right? Jibreel alayhi salam. And according to that story that was verified by many of the scholars, Jibreel alayhi salam opened up the chest of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and took his heart and washed his heart in a container that was filled with what? Filled with water of Zamzam, right? And then he put it back, and ever since the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would be repulsed. He would be disgusted at any form of evil, right? The natural tendency of his heart became to just do good things and beautiful things. What they have not told you, however, is that this incident took place twice in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Shaqq al-sadr, they call it. Hadithatu shaqq al-sadr. Happened once when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was still a little kid, 5-year-old kid with Halima al-Sa'diyya. But it also happened another time that is very, very relevant to this time of year that we enjoy and celebrate these days. So the Prophet ﷺ was sleeping at the house of Ummu Hani' bint Abi Talib, Ali's sister, his cousin sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he was asleep at her house. She was in sort of like his own mother. She was, you know, an elderly woman, and he loved her. She raised him practically, right? So he was sleeping at her house, and then at night, after he prayed Isha, Jibreel alayhi salam came to him one more time. And in that incident, the Prophet ﷺ is an adult who lived in Mecca. And Jibreel did the same thing that he did to him when he was a little kid. He opened up the Prophet's chest, took his heart and washed it in the water of Zamzam, and then told him, Ya Muhammad, you need to be ready for this journey that I'm going to take you on. And I want you to be ready for it with your heart, with your mind. And I want you to be completely cleansed in order for you to deserve the honor that comes with that journey. And Jibreel alayhi salam took the Prophet ﷺ outside the house, as you know the story. And he asked him to ride this remarkable means of transportation that historians came to call al-buraq, right? And the word buraq from barq. Barq in Arabic is lightning. Al-buraq is the animal that speeds, or the mount that moves with the speed of light almost. You know, as the scholars describe it, al-buraq would land its hoof at the very spot that it gazes upon, right? So it looks at the horizon, and that's where basically it lands its hoof. And the Prophet ﷺ told us that before he mounts al-buraq shook. It was shaken in awe of this person that is going to ride me, so to speak. So he was shaken a little bit, and the Prophet ﷺ was in enough hesitation, as it is. So he stopped. And before he rides al-buraq, he stopped. And Jibreel alayhi salam looked at al-Buraq and told him, أمسك عليك نفسك. Take it easy and be still. فوالله ما ركبك أحد أعز عند الله من هذا. I swear no one ever mounted you that is more honorable in the sight of God than this man that is about to ride you. So al-Buraq stood still and allowed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to ride it. And al-Buraq took Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam on this remarkable journey that most of the scholars tell us happened on the night of the 27th of Rajab. And this is the last week of Rajab that we have just started, and it only makes sense for us to remind ourselves of the beauty of this journey and the consequences of this journey. Al-Buraq took Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Jibreel all the way to the city of Jerusalem, Al-Quds. And when he arrived at Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, he was thirsty, so the Jibreel alayhi salam offered him milk and wine. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, naturally, with the natural tendency of his heart, he extended his hand and he took the wine cup, the milk cup instead of the wine cup. And Jibreel alayhi salam told him, you have selected the fitrah. You have selected the good tendency of the heart. And had you selected wine, perhaps you and your ummah could have been misguided, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Jibreel invited him to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. You know, those of you who have ever visited it, you know, the very first qibla that was ever given to the believers was Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, right? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam enters the masjid and he is stunned by the scene of all the prophets and messengers, all of them standing there in rows, waiting for who to lead them in prayer? Our beloved, my beloved and yours, Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And Rasulullah stood there, and I want you to imagine the scene. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, and he was a man that cried very easily, was always overtaken by emotions. You know, his tear was very near, as they say. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, there he is, standing in the presence of those prophets and messengers that he had not met before. And Adam is there, and Ibrahim is there, and Sulaiman is there, and Nuh is there, and Idris is there, and Harun, and Musa, and Isa. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, I mean, in our own Salatul Jama'ah, we always hesitate. We have to ask someone else to lead, right? No, you lead. No, you lead, right? Imagine the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam asking Adam to lead, and asking Ibrahim to lead, and asking Isa to lead, and then, ya Muhammad, you lead us. You lead us. You are the most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam leads them in prayer. And it's perhaps the most beautiful Salatul Jama'ah that was ever performed on the face of this planet. Every pure soul came together, all of them came together, and all of them prayed together, led by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And after that, something remarkable happened, brothers and sisters. Jibreel alayhi salam told Muhammad, ya Muhammad, the journey is only going to get more interesting. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, what more interesting? Is there something that is more remarkable and more amazing than what I have already seen so far? And Jibreel said to him, you just wait. And he orders al-Buraq this time to ascend. It's not traveling horizontally anymore. It is traveling vertically. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is lifted into heavens. Now people always, you know, bring up the disagreement between the scholars. Was that journey really in the flesh, or was it a vision that the Prophet saw? Was it by his soul or by his physical body? Doesn't matter. None of that matters, right? What matters is that it did happen some way, one way or another, it did happen, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us about it, alayhi salatu wasalam. But before they are able to penetrate through the first heaven, the first cosmic system, so to speak, the angels, the guardians of that system, they stopped them. And they said to Jibreel alayhi salam, who is it? So he says, I am Jibreel, I am the chief of the angels. No. We're not asking about you, Jibreel. We know who you are. But who would you bring with you? No man is supposed to be lifted to these territories, to these domains. They are not for men. So Jibreel alayhi salam told him, what if I told you that that is the most beloved of God's creation, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. And the angels immediately said, is it Muhammad? Alayhi salatu wasalam. And Jibreel says, yes, it is Muhammad, alayhi salatu wasalam, my friend. And then they asked the Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, ya Muhammad, hal bu'ift? Have you already been sent as a prophet? And he says, I guess so. That is why I'm here. And then the angels said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, this is a day on which the entire universe celebrates. We have been waiting for you to come, and there you are. We finally see you for the first time. And the angels gave safe passage to Jibreel alayhi salam and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And they continue to ascend, Sama' al-Ula. In the very first level of heaven, they meet this elderly man who is weighed down by time, by anxiety. And all the souls of the sons and daughters of Adam are ascending. And every time he looks at a soul, if it's a soul that is destined to Jannah, he smiles and he celebrates with joy. And if it's a soul that is going to hellfire, he is extremely anxious and depressed and he cries. And the Prophet ﷺ asks Jibreel alayhi salam, ya Jibreel, who is that? And Jibreel tells him, that is Adam alayhi salam. He feels responsible for all the good deeds and the bad deeds of the sons and daughters of Adam. And he continues to witness all those souls going up right before his own eyes. And then the Prophet ﷺ moves into the second level. And at the second level, he meets the two prophets that were cousins. Remember them? Yahya wa Isa alayhim as-salam. And the Prophet ﷺ greets them. And they say to him, Marhaban bin Nabi as-Salih wal Akh as-Salih. We welcome you. You are a great prophet and you are a great brother. And the Prophet ﷺ ascends to the third level. And then he meets this really good-looking, handsome man that captured his heart immediately. And he asked Jibreel, ya Jibreel, who is that? No. Don't tell me. I think that's Yusuf. And Jibreel alayhi salam, yes, that is Yusuf alayhi salam, your brother. And Yusuf greets him, ya Muhammad, it is good to see you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevated you above all of us. And we are so grateful for this. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam ascends to the fourth level, at which he meets Ilyas alayhi salam. And that's when the Prophet says, وَرَفَعْنَاهُ مَكَانًا عَلِيًّا. Recites the ayah in the Quran that says that Allah elevated Ilyas to the highest of levels. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam moves to the fifth, at which he meets Harun alayhi salam. And then he moves to the sixth, at which he meets Musa alayhi salam. And he describes Musa as a tall man with rugged features and a dark skin, serious look in his eyes, alayhi wa ala nabiyyina salatu wassalam. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam moves to the seventh heaven, at which he meets a good-looking elderly man with a white beard who is leaning his back on that structure that exists in heaven that resembles Kaaba exactly. It's identical to Kaaba, and it's in the seventh heaven, right on top of Kaaba, and it's called Al-Baytul Ma'mur, the dwelled house. You know why they call it the dwelled house? Because every single day 70,000 of the angels go inside and come out, and they never do it again. Every single day, different 70,000 angels enter Al-Bayt al-Ma'mur and leave it. And then the following day, it's a different 70. And then the following day, another 70. And the following day, another 70, all the way until the Day of Judgment. Every single day, a different group of 70,000 angels enter Al-Bayt al-Ma'mur. To do what? To celebrate the praises of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and mention His name. And the Prophet ﷺ asked his very close friend Jibreel alayhi salam, ya Jibreel, who is that man that is leaning his back on Al-Bayt al-Ma'mur? And he says, that is your forefather Ibrahim alayhi salam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam goes up to him, and that's when he hugs him. It's his own blood. And he greets Ibrahim alayhi salam, and Ibrahim tells him, Marhaban bin Nabi al-Salih wal Ibn al-Salih. I welcome you. You are a good and a great prophet and a great son of mine. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was elevated to the following level, and that is Sidratul Muntaha. It is that tree at which all human knowledge ends. You and I don't understand what lies after. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam naturally walked forward, in order to pass Sidratul Muntaha, right? What is, by the way, next? What is the door that is next to Sidratul Muntaha, as the Quran says in Surah Al-Najm? عندها جنة المأوى. The doors of heaven, the doors of Jannah, are immediately next to Sidratul Muntaha. Subhanallah. And the Prophet ﷺ takes a couple of steps forward in order to enter, in order to pass. And he looks right and he looks left and he does not see Jibreel alayhi salam. And he realizes that Jibreel is still lingering behind and standing before the tree and he was not able to pass. Ya Jibreel, my friend, why are you not walking with me? You've been with me throughout the entire trip. This is not the time to leave me. And Jibreel alayhi salam says, Ya Muhammad, you have been given permission to pass. I have not. فَأَنْتَ إِنَّمَا إِذَا اخْتَرَقْتَ فَإِنَّمَا أَنْتَ إِذَا تَقَدَّمْتَ اخْتَرَقْتَ وَإِنَّمَا أَنَا إِذَا تَقَدَّمْتَ احْتَرَقْتَ. If I attempt to move forward, I will burn. But if you attempt to move forward, you have already been given the leave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You will pass. Brothers and sisters, I want you to realize that your Prophet and my Prophet, your beloved and mine, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, was given a maqam. He was given a place that is more honorable than that of the angels themselves, including Jibreel alayhi salam. None of the angels were ever allowed to enter into that domain. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam keeps walking forward until he comes into the immediate presence of the Lord himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he could not see the Lord because of all this light. Yes, he spoke to the Lord without any barriers, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not see him. That only happens on the Day of Judgment. Imagine if you come into the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what would you say? What would you say? The Prophet ﷺ ran out of words. So he says, At-tahiyyatu lillah. May the greetings be upon Allah. Was-salawatu, and the prayers. Wat-tayyibat, and all the blessings. He thought that As-salamu alaykum is the greeting that you and I use in the life of this world. It is not the proper way to greet the Lord Himself. At-tahiyyatu lillah, was-salawatu, wat-tayyibat. And what does the Lord say back to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? As-salamu alayka ayyuha al-Nabi. May the peace be upon you, O Prophet. As-salamu alayka ayyuha al-Nabi wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Allah taught him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the proper greeting between us humans and the proper greeting between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is still as-salam. The beautiful greeting of Islam. As-salamu alaykum. When people tell you, be selective with whom you say assalamu alaykum, tell them this is not the spirit of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You spread that peace to anyone and everyone as often as you can, as frequently as you can, as strongly and emphatically as you can, because this is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us. He greeted Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with at-tahiyyat, and Allah greeted him back with as-salam. Assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabi wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And then the Prophet replied and said to him, As-salamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi s-salihin. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam could have said to himself, oh my goodness, Allah addressed me. And he says, As-salamu alayka, on you, Muhammad. May the peace be unto you, Muhammad. This is my moment to shine. This is my moment to speak to Allah. It is my moment to rise. It is my moment to take advantage of this as much as possible and pray. And it's me. It's about me. I mean, I am the one that was raised here. I'm the one that was brought here. Rather, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam says, As-salamu alayna. May that peace, Lord, be upon us. What is us? Us is the Prahfet and the companions and Ahlul Bayt and the Tabi'een and the Muslim men and women that followed them. Us, brothers and sisters, is you and I. The Prophet ﷺ at that moment did not lose sight of his responsibility as the leader of our ummah. And he did not lose sight of his responsibility as our inspiration. And he remembered us before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, As-salamu alayna. Lord, thank you for extending that peace unto me, but please extend it to my ummah as well. As-salamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi s-salihin. And unto all the righteous worshippers of God. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. And that conversation between the Lord and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam became the foundation of our tashahud, right? that we recite in our tashahud when we sit down in our prayer, you know, every time we pray fard or sunnah, this is why we say it, right? And in the second half of tashahud, what do we say? Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, right? The Prophet ﷺ reached that honorable level. So we honor the Prophet by these praises as well, right? Allahumma salli ala, ya Allah, extend your peace upon the Prophet and the family of the Prophet as you have done to Ibrahim and the family of Ibrahim, right? Ibrahim, the family of Ibrahim, right? They're all prophets. The lineage of Ibrahim, they're all prophets. Ismail and Ishaq and their Ishaq's sons and so on and so forth, Yaqub. Such honor that would extend it to the family of Ibrahim alayhi salam, right? But when Ibrahim, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Ibrahim, I will make you among the a'imna, I will make you among the leaders of humanity, right? What did Ibrahim ask Allah? He asks Allah, would you extend that honor to all of my offspring as well? قَالَ وَمِن ذُرِّيَّتِي, would you extend that to my ذُرِّيَّة, to my progeny, to my descendants as well? What did Allah say? Subhanahu wa ta'ala, قَالَ لَا يَنَالُ عَهْدِ الظَّالِمِينَ, the honor of my trust is not extended to the aggressors. Every man for himself. You are the descendant of Ibrahim, you are the descendant of Muhammad, it is all on you. You do the righteous deeds, you know, آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, أهلاً وسهلاً. You are welcome. We bring you in. You follow your whim and your desire, sorry. There is no cronyism and nepotism in Islam. Just because you carry the blood of a prophet does not necessarily make you anything different than anyone else. It is your deeds and it's your actions. But we still extend our prayers to the Prophet ﷺ and his family nonetheless. Because that is the love of Ahlul Bayt is part and parcel of our Iman and our faith as believers. Sunni or Shia, it doesn't matter. This is one of the fundamentals of Islam, right? The Prophet ﷺ taught us in the Quran and he speaks to the believers, قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى, I do not ask you to do me any favors except that you take care of my family, that you honor my family. And the Prophet ﷺ says in the ahadith that are in Bukhari and Muslim and all the great books, the love of Ahlul Bayt is part of your Iman and hating Ahlul Bayt is part of nifaq, of hypocrisy, right? So you never make this into a sectarian matter. Loving the Prophet ﷺ and his family and honoring them is what we recite in our salah every single day. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Right? Now why in salah? Why tashahud in particular? Because something amazing happened, brothers and sisters. After that conversation between Allah and Muhammad ﷺ, one of the most essential and fundamental acts of worship in Islam was ordained. Right? The five daily prayers. And of course, growing up, they always told us the stories about, you know, Allah ordaining 55 first, and then, you know, they kept going back and forth in this negotiation process. You know, some scholars, you know, cast some shadow of weakness on this hadith, right? But what we know for sure is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained the five daily prayers, you know, from above seven heavens. It is not an ayah that was revealed in the Quran. It is not a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like, you know, fasting and zakah and hajj and all this. These are things we learn right here on earth. But salah was ordained up there. It was ordained in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. Ya Muhammad, I want your ummah to pray to me five times every day. And he described the nature and the structure of salah and what is said and what is not said. And wallahi, brothers and sisters, I want you to imagine the world without salah. Imagine the world without, imagine salatul jum'ah. I shouldn't say Salatul Jum'ah anymore, right? Imagine just Khutbatul Jum'ah. And the Imam stands here and says a few words, and then, you know, after we are done, we don't say Aqim As-Salah, we say thank you very much. Jazakallah khair. And then we just stand up and greet each other and eat and talk and walk away. Imagine if there's no ruku'ah. Imagine if there's no sujood. When you put your forehead on the ground and you speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the heart. Imagine if there's no tashahud, if there's no fatiha. Imagine if there's no tahajjud and qiyam and taraweeh. If there's no fajr and isha. Imagine how, what kind of life would that be, subhanAllah. You and I cannot even imagine that. We cannot imagine to exist without praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our beautiful, structured, oh my goodness, it's dhuhr time, let's pray. Imagine. Imagine that life does not have salah. that is why the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام taught us that your salah is the most fundamental act of worship in your deen. It's the most important thing. من أقامها أقام الدين ومن هدمها هدم الدين. If you establish your salah, you've established Islam. And if you compromise your salah, you've compromised the entirety of Islam. This is one territory you don't play with. This is one territory you can never say, well, you know, I'm not in the mood today. This is one territory you cannot say, I'm tired. Your salah, your salah, your salah. As the Prophet ﷺ used to say, salatuka, salatuka, lahmuka wa damuk. Your prayer is equivalent to your own life. Your prayer is like your blood and your flesh. You cling to it as strongly as possible. It doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter what is happening in life. The Prophet ﷺ taught us that, you know, if you're sick, you pray while sitting. And if you cannot pray while sitting, you pray while laying on your back. If you cannot pray while, you know, by moving your head and your neck, pray by moving your eyelids. And if you cannot move your eyelids, pray with in your heart. But you still have to pray. If you are riding your car and you absolutely cannot find a spot to pray, the companions of the Prophet ﷺ used to pray while riding their camels. Because they'd be scared, like if they park somewhere and tie their camels and pray, maybe bandits or something would attack them. If you are worried, you know, have some anxiety about praying, pray while sitting in your car. But you should always pray. Everywhere you go, you should always pray. Traveling, fine. We're giving you qasr and jam'. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy. Combine your prayers and make it shorter. But you always, always pray, no matter what. And then the Prophet ﷺ finished and concluded his journey and came back to this earth. And he woke Ummu Hani up. Of course, it took like seconds, you know, in our time, it took seconds. You know, space travel, when you're going with the speed of light, you know, the second in our space is like 6 months over here. So the Prophet ﷺ, it took him a fraction of a second. When he came back, Ummu Hani was still asleep. He woke her up and he told her all about it. And she said, Ya Muhammad, don't tell anyone about this. People will mock you, they will make fun of you, don't do it. And the Prophet ﷺ told her, are you kidding me? I am telling everyone about this. This is an honor I have to share. So he goes the following day and he tells everyone in Mecca. Right? And they immediately go to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Ya Abu Bakr, did you hear what your friend says? He says that trip that takes us a month back and forth, 2 months back and forth, he took it overnight. And what does Abu Bakr as-Siddiq say? إن كان قالها فقد صدق. If it is something that came out of Muhammad's mouth, then it is true. I don't care what it is. And they told him, Ya Muhammad, okay, tell us. Describe Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa for us. And they brought a couple of guys that have been there before. Alhamdulillah, I visited it. Some of you visited Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, right? Muhammad ﷺ never visited it, except on that trip. Ya Muhammad, describe Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa for us. And the Prophet ﷺ hesitated initially. I mean, you're going there to lead the prophets in prayer. He did not have a notepad going around, you know, documenting all the little designs and corners and structures in the building. He wasn't even paying attention. So he hesitated initially, and that's when the kuffar of Quraysh said, see, we told you he's a liar. And some believers renounced their Islam on the spot when that happened. And then something miraculous happened. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he started describing it as if it was a movie playing before his own eyes. And he says, وَفَعُرِضَ عَلَيَّ الْمَسْجِدُ الْأَقْصَى عَرْضًا وَكَأَنِّي أَرَاهُ رَأْيَ الْعَيْنِ. It was presented to me as if I could see it with my own eyes. And he kept describing every corner and every little piece in Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. And every time he says something, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, who had already visited before, would say, صَدَقْتَ يَا مُحَمَّد. That is true, Ya Muhammad. Every time he says something, sadaqt. Every time he says something, sadaqt. And at the end of the day, the Prophet ﷺ looked at him and he says, Ya Abu Bakr, from this day on, I will call you as-Siddiq. I will call you as-Siddiq. And everyone that renounced their Islam, they came back to their deen right in that moment when they saw the Prophet ﷺ reveal to them the descriptions of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa and they saw that miracle unfold before their own eyes. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us our sins and to accept our good deeds. I ask Allah to inspire our hearts with the life and legacy and the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers and sisters, raise your hands and speak to Allah from the heart. Ud'u Allah wa antum muqinuna bil ijaba. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين به ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وقائد الغر الميامين محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم في الأولين وفي الآخرين وفي الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك على محمد وآله وعلى أصحابه وأتباعه ومن اهتدى بهديه وعمل بسنته إلى يوم الدين، وارض عنا معهم بفضلك وكرمك أرحم الراحمين، اللهم آمين. Brothers and sisters, just a quick reminder, speaking to the hearts today, reminding us of the legacy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, reminding ourselves of al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, the journey of to Jerusalem and the ascension to heaven that Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam undertook with Jibreel alayhi salam. And I wanted again to ignite that spark of love to Rasulullah in our hearts. I always say, you know, almost in every talk I give and every lecture and every presentation or khutbah, I always say that the number one guarantee to help you always stay the course and to be on the path is to have the love of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam and Allah in your heart. Just the mere conviction of what is right and what is wrong is not sufficient all the time. But loving Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam will almost guarantee every time that you will do everything in your capacity, inshallah, to follow him and to teach your children about his legacy alayhi salatu wasalam. Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj is a remarkable journey. And like I said, it caused the scholars to disagree a little bit on whether or not the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam actually took that journey in the flesh. But I always say that is a completely irrelevant question. We believe that that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We believe in the day of judgment. We believe in much more remarkable things. Why is it so hard to believe that Allah with some incredible means of technology that has a scientific explanation, but obviously the Arabs at the time did not understand it, actually took the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from one place to the other. Whether it happened in the flesh or the Prophet ﷺ had a vision of this whole thing doesn't really matter. What matters is an ayah in the Quran. And this ayah in the Quran I wanted to remind you of. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, speaks of this experience, this whole thing that happened with the Prophet ﷺ, and he calls it fitna. Allah calls this a trial. الآية التي أريناكها. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this ayah, this remarkable experience, and he calls it fitna. He calls it a trial. What is the difference between a trial and a miracle? I mean, Isa alayhi salam had a miracle, and his miracle was he used to walk on water, he used to bring back the dead, and so on and so forth, right? Salih alayhi salam had a miracle. What was the miracle of Salih alayhi salam? He carved out the camel from the mountain and it started walking, right? What is the miracle of Musa alayhi salam? He used his staff and he splits the sea, right? There's so many prophets that had miracles. What is the miracle of Nuh alayhi salam? He builds the ark and he brings all the animals on it and all the humans and so on and so forth, and then the flood takes place. Again, there's so many prophets that have miracles. If you look at the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are extraordinary things that happen in his life, here and there. But we always say to ourselves, the greatest miracle of Islam is what? Isra wal-Mi'raj? No. It doesn't even really matter to us that much. The true miracle of Islam is the Qur'an. It is the Qur'an. And let me tell you why. A miracle is intended to impress an audience, right? So if I am, if there's a prophet over here and that prophet wants to convince you that he's a prophet, he does something, extraordinary. And when you see something that defies the rules of physics and science, you say, oh, must have gotten some help from God, right? That is the idea of a miracle, is to impress a group of people and to cause them to be convinced that I actually represent the divine, right? But here's what happens. There's about 120, 130 people here. A miracle is performed. When you leave this place, you will immediately start telling that story to other people, right? Now, do you think that the impact of the miracle on you will be the same as the impact of the story you're telling on your cousin when you go home. And you call your cousin, you know, in another state and say, oh my God, you're not going to believe what I saw at Jum'ah today. Right? The power of the miracle will gradually fade. The group that saw the miracle for the first time will be the one to be most impressed. Right? That is the group that will be most impressed. But then when we take the miracle and start describing it to other people, it becomes a story. And when that other group takes the story and tells the story to another group of people, it becomes a tale. And then it becomes a legend. And then it becomes a myth. And across generations, it just becomes a folk story. Right? It carries no meaning anymore. What does it bring to your heart when we say that, you know, the Prophet ﷺ had that Isra wal Mi'raj, or that Musa split the sea with his staff? You say, oh, mashallah, that's an interesting thing. That's cool. That's it, because it's just a story. But if you were there standing next to Musa alayhi salam and you saw the Red Sea split, oh, it'll be a completely different thing, right? But for you, it's just a cool story. It's an interesting story. They made movies out of it. You watch the movie and you eat popcorn, because it just became a legend. The only reason we still believe in the veracity of those stories is that they were included in what? In the Quran. Meaning the Qur'an as a document is more powerful than the miracle itself. Because we only believe that miracle actually happened because it was mentioned in the Qur'an. That's the only reason we believe it. Not just the Qur'an, I mean the Bible also mentioned many of those miracles. The scriptures, the books that came from God Himself, right? You say they happened because they are included right there in the scriptures that God revealed. And the thing about miracles, brothers and sisters, is that miracles resemble a spiritual experience. Have you ever seen someone like this? Who was so far away from Islam and then comes to the masjid and all of a sudden starts praying. Subhanallah, you know, I'm so glad to see you. Why did you start praying? All of a sudden you're becoming religious. Man, I had an amazing spiritual experience a couple of days ago. I saw this and that happen to me, or, you know, I had a dream. Right? It happens like in the Christian community. This happens a lot, where people think that they saw Jesus or saw the Virgin Mary. Right? It's an experience that you go through. What happens to spiritual experiences over time? They fade. It just becomes a memory. You're not even sure if you actually saw it or not. Right? But the one thing that always stays with you across time and generations is that book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is called the Quran. Your iman goes down, you open the Quran. Your iman goes up, you open the Quran. Your heart is there, you open the Qur'an. Your heart is not there anymore, you open the Qur'an. Right? You are so keen in your ibadah, you open the Qur'an. You're so bored in the matters of ibadah, you open the Qur'an. The Qur'an will always keep you at that steady state. But if you subject your faith to spiritual experiences and stories and tales, then they lose their effect over time, unfortunately. Because if the human beings, as Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا مَنَعَنَا أَن نُرْسِلَ بِالْآيَاتِ إِلَّا أَن كَذَّبَ بِهَا الْأَوَّلُونَ. The only reason I decided not to send miracles with Muhammad is because previous nations were exposed to the miracles and they gave the lie to those miracles. Of all the followers of Ibrahim alayhi salam that saw him, you know, coming out of the fire, the followers of Lut, the followers of Salih and Hud and Isa, how many people saw the miracle but they did not subscribe to the faith afterwards? Right? The vast majority, actually, of people who saw those miracles, they would not subscribe to the faith. And only a small group that does. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا مَنَعَنَا أَن نُرْسِلِ الْآيَاتِ إِلَّا أَن كَذَّبَ بِهَا الْأَوَّلُونَ. People in previous nations, they received the miracles. What did they do with the miracles? But I decided to give you a miracle that will continue to be alive in your hearts and in your lives every single day, and that is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is precisely relevant right now, about a month left before Ramadan. And Ramadan, Shahrul Qur'an. It is the month in which the Qur'an was revealed. It is the month in which the Qur'an is honored and celebrated. It is the month in which the Qur'an is recited and memorized. It is the month in which the Qur'an is implemented and understood and explained. It's the month in which the Qur'an is taught. And inshallah, about a month, I just wanted to remind you, Isra and Mi'raj and Ramadan, there's a month between them, right? And the theme of that month is the Qur'an. So right now, you start getting into the business of connecting with the Qur'an. You know, so that you don't, when Ramadan actually starts, you know, you don't feel like, you know, okay, I need to start reading the Qur'an now. And then it takes you a week, maybe 10 days, to get into like the mood of reading the Qur'an and studying the Qur'an on a daily basis. And by the time you're there, it's the 20th of Ramadan. So you're cramming everything for 10 days and then it's Eid and it's over. And you go back to your life again. But if you give yourself a head start, inshallah, let's say tomorrow, you know, Saturday, you start with a little bit of recitation of the Qur'an, you know, maybe half a page every day, and you keep doing this, I promise you, by the time Ramadan starts, you hit the ground running right away and you're right there. There's no waste of any time, inshallah, right? And don't just be among those who recite the Qur'an mindlessly without understanding anything. If you recite the Qur'an and you don't learn something from your recitation, you're wasting your time. I'm just telling you right, straight up. You might get some hasanat, but it has not really influenced your life in a meaningful way. And I always say to people, the Qur'an has a finite number of Arabic words. You say about 4,500 words or something like that, unique words. A lot less if you talk about, you know, root words and their derivatives, right? It'd be like less than 2,000 words. And so if you memorize and understand the 2,000 words in the Qur'an with their derivatives, I promise you, in 3-4 years, you are good to go when it comes to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you're not trying to learn Arabic, because I know that scares people. We're not trying to learn a new language, right? You're just trying to build your vocabulary of the Qur'an. So every time you read the Qur'an, just pick one word. 365 words a year, you know, in 3-4 years, you're done. And then you start opening the Qur'an and you make the connections on your own. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fill your hearts with the love of Allah, His Messenger, and the Qur'an. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this day to bring so many blessings into our lives, to forgive our sins. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those whose hearts flutter with the love of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, whose hearts beat with the love of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I ask Allah to always connect us with the Prophet and his legacy and his life and his seerah. I ask Allah Azza wa Jal on this day to forgive us our sins and to establish us firmly on His path. And I ask Allah to make us among Ahlul Qur'an, among the people of the Qur'an, and those are the people of Allah. And I ask Allah Azza wa Jal on this day to strengthen our hearts and to give us the best state of preparedness for Ramadan. And I ask Allah to make this upcoming Ramadan the most beautiful month we've ever experienced. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us in the month of Ramadan. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower His blessings upon us in the month of Ramadan. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us a new chance to live again in the month of Ramadan. I ask Allah to bring us away from the darkness into the light in that month of Ramadan. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove our burdens in the month of Ramadan. And I ask Allah azza wa jal by the end of Ramadan that we will be new people, that we will be saved, that we will be forgiven, and that we'll start a new life and a new chapter with the Creator and the Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala in this life. And I ask Allah, as He gathered us here as brothers and sisters, that will He gather all of us in His Jannah on the Day of Judgment. Allahumma ameen. Allahumma aghfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa thabbit aqdamana wa ansurna ala al-qawm al-kafirin. Taqabbal minna innaka anta as-samiyul alim. Wa tub alayna ya Rabbana innaka anta at-tawwabur rahim. Allahumma balighna Ramadan. Allahumma balighna Ramadan. Allahumma balighna Ramadan. A'waman ba'da a'wam. واغفر لنا فيه برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين اللهم حببنا في رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وحببنا في سيره المصطفى وحببنا في القران الكريم واجعلنا من اهل القران يا ربنا الذين هم اهلك وخاصتك اللهم يا ربنا وكما امنا بمحمد ولم نره فلا تفرق بيننا وبينه حتى تدخلنا مدخله اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات المسلمين والمسلمات الاحياء منهم والاموات انك سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات يا رب العالمين واقم الصلاه ان الصلاه كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا